Good morning and welcome to the 20th meeting of the COVID-19 committee. Before we begin, can I remind any members, witnesses, staff and others present that social distancing measures are in place in committee rooms and must be observed. This means that face coverings must also be worn on entering, moving around and leaving the committee room. And as a limited number of seating positions are provided, that ensures that people are at least 2 meters apart. And for this reason, face coverings may be removed once people are seated. Can I also highlight that this is a hybrid meeting with some members participating in the room whilst others are joining us by video conference. Can I remind members and witnesses that broadcasting colleagues will operate your microphone, so please kindly refrain from touching them. I now turn to the substantive item of business, and I would like to welcome the First Minister and Dr. Gregor Smith, the Chief Medical Officer, to this meeting. Can I thank you both for making time to appear before this committee? The purpose of this meeting is to take evidence from the First Minister and Dr. Smith on the Scottish Government's new strategic framework for responding to COVID-19, and we're also considering the secondary legislation that underpins the framework, namely the Health Protection, Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements, Local Alert Level Scotland Regulations 2020, and the Health Protection, Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements, Local Levels Scotland Amendment Regulations 2020. And First Minister, can I invite you to make an opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. I intend to be very brief in my opening statement. Firstly, I welcome the opportunity to appear here today with the Chief Medical Officer to engage with the committee both on the general strategy of the government in tackling COVID, but also to the extent you wish on the detail of the regulations. I think it might be worth just to set the scene with a very brief summary of the position that I think we are in as of now. I think we have some grounds for cautious optimism that the steps we've taken in recent weeks are having an impact, and a positive impact. That's a combination of the household restrictions and the restrictions on hospitality, but more importantly than that, the compliance of the public with all of the rules and guidance. We have seen a tailing off in the rate of increase in infection. It remains to be seen over the next few days whether that continues. On the other side, we don't feel yet we've any room for complacency or to take great comfort from the situation we're seeing. I tried to set out some of this yesterday, that given the nature of what we face right now, it's not sufficient for us to arrest a deterioration in the situation. We really need to see the level of infection decline significantly. And the reason for that is that if we go deeper into the winter with a high baseline of infection, then any even quite marginal increase in the R number would risk the virus overwhelming us, and that would have significant implications for the National Health Service and, of course, for health and life. So the situation we're in just now is fragile and requires the utmost care and caution to be taken. Obviously, we monitor the health data very closely, but we also consider the wider impacts of the steps we are taking. Final comment would be, we believe the strategic framework and the five levels framework gives us the flexibility that we need to respond in a proportionate and targeted way. It is open to us, should the evidence suggest it's necessary, to apply a single level across the whole country. But of course, if that is not merited, it gives us the flexibility to respond in a more targeted and proportionate way. Obviously, we need to keep all of that under review as we go through the next days and weeks. So I think I'll probably leave it there, because I suspect a lot of the detail that you want to hear from me and from the Chief Medical Officer will come through the questioning.
Thank you very much. We'll now turn to members' questions. And if I may begin by asking the first question, actually, to pick up on the point you made in closing there. As a point of clarification, if a national lockdown becomes unavoidable, would you achieve that through the strategic framework?
That would be our aim. Mm. So I think when there has been, inevitably, in the wake of decisions elsewhere in the UK, discussion about the likelihood or otherwise of Scotland moving to a further national lockdown, I think implicit in some of that questioning has been the view that that would mean a move away from the levels framework. That is not the case. A national lockdown for Scotland would be achieved through the national application of level four. Now, as we say in the detail of the framework, there are some choices to be made within level four. It sets out very clearly that may or may not, depending on the circumstances, include a stay-at-home message, perhaps backed by regulation. So in each level at each time, there may be some choices to be made around the detail, but national lockdown, should it happen, and let me just state for the record, I hope it doesn't have to happen, and you know we will do everything we can to avoid that, but obviously can't rule it out, but that would be through the application of a level four approach.
Okay, thank you. You touched on the general picture of where we're at and the various indicators, some of which are positive, some of which are not so. This perhaps is a question for both you and for the Chief Medical Officer, but when you consider the indicators, the five indicators in the framework, is there a hierarchy of indicators? Is there one sort of data set that you turn to first, for example, or is it a much more holistic process?
I'll maybe start and then Gregor will be able to go into more detail here. We don't have a hierarchy in a strict sense, and nor do we have a weighting that, you know, 20% goes to this one and 20% goes to the other. We look at it in the round, and as I set out to Parliament last week, even the indicators are not the whole picture. We have to apply context and judgment to those. And, you know, we will look at not just what the cases per 100,000 are in an area, but what the direction of travel is. Is that rising or falling? I suppose, though, if there is one I don't want to give the sense that it becomes the key driver, but obviously health service capacity is an immediate issue that if we look at any area or across the country and think we're going to breach intensive care capacity, then that possibly would drive some, you know, pretty urgent action. And you know, while I'm not here to speak for the decisions of other governments, listening to the Chief Medical Officer in England over the weekend, clearly concerns about hospital capacity are one of the drivers of the decision that's been taken there. So that doesn't mean that is the most important factor, but it, in terms of urgency and the one that would, you know, potentially prompt some, you know, immediate action, that would be one. But I'll hand over to Gregor to say a bit more.
Yes, thanks for your question. In trying to develop this process and identifying the indicators that inform that process, I think the first thing I would say about it is it's really important not to get drawn into too mechanistic a process as well. These indicators are there to inform the discussion and the judgment that then flows from that. And there's no particular weighting which is given to any of these indicators. All of them are valuable, and valuable in different ways as we approach that process. Equally, we take into account a lot of other information as well, what you might view as kind of secondary considerations in their relation to perhaps the demographics of particular areas, the particular constraints of how densely populated those are, vulnerability within those areas. All these factors are brought to bear. So I think your description of it being a holistic process is a good one. It's a holistic process that ultimately requires fine judgments to be made, and those judgments are arrived through consensus from a variety of different sources.
Thank you. My final question is about a statement in the accompanying documents to the framework, which says the framework is meant to be more straightforward and transparent. I think we've all been aware of some criticism about inconsistencies of application. We had some evidence last week on this. For instance, certain areas being placed at one level despite measuring on another level in many of the indicators of health board areas not mirroring local authority areas, and that throwing out inconsistencies, and of, say, large local authority areas where measures are determined by a big urban area and not necessarily reflecting more remote areas. Given those anomalies and the need for buy-in from the public, do you consider the new framework to be more straightforward and transparent than what came before?
I do think it is more straightforward and transparent, but that is a relative answer, and I'm going to be pretty straight here, because it's, to be frank, one of the things I've struggled with as a decision maker. We are not dealing with an exact science, and we are not dealing with a situation. It would make life easier for for all of us, actually, if we were, but we're not dealing with a situation where you can feed certain indicators into a computer and the computer then feeds out the answer for you. And that's where, you know, as CMO has said there, we cannot have a purely mechanistic process, because unfortunately the geography of our country, the interdependencies between different areas, and just the vagaries of how an infectious virus spreads and operates means that we have to look very carefully and to a large extent be driven by the data. We cannot avoid a situation where we have to apply judgment to that. And if you take Lanarkshire last week, on many of the indicators, and you know, we're looking at Lanarkshire amongst other areas very carefully on an ongoing basis, but if you did it purely mechanistically, it would have taken you in one direction, but then you have views from the public health community in Lanarkshire, the local authority, the police, who all say, look, we think we have got a package of measures that have things going in the right direction. And you know, there was also a sense from the data that things were levelling off. So you have to apply a judgment there, given the severity of putting any area into level four. So there is always going to be, and I think it's just necessary for me to be straight about this, there is always going to be a degree of subjectivity about these decisions. I just don't think there is any escaping that. The judgment I've made in terms of how to try to deal with that in a public sense is to try as regularly and as clearly as I can, and you know, don't always succeed, is in setting out to the public exactly the factors we're taking account of, how our decisions are driven, how they're arrived at, and also to try to be, which I think we'd all recognise as politicians here is usually the most difficult thing any politician can do, is embrace and explain the inherent uncertainties in that and try to have that ongoing regular dialogue with the public about that. But I think we'd make a big mistake if we allowed ourselves to simply take that mechanistic, almost algorithm-driven approach, because then you wouldn't take account of, you know, travel patterns from East Lothian to Lothian or Aberdeenshire to Aberdeen, or the position of the borders right now, for example, where it is almost sandwiched between the north of England with higher prevalence and other parts of Scotland with higher prevalence. So these things matter in terms of how the virus transmits, because the virus transmits based on human interactions.
Thank you. Can I turn next to the Deputy Convener, Monica Lennon?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. First Minister, you mentioned Lanarkshire, so if I can stick with Lanarkshire for a moment. We're a couple of days into level three, and you were very open in saying that this would be looked at daily for Lanarkshire and for other areas. But it already feels like there's sort of strong hints emerging that we might see further restrictions, we might end up in level four. And it's very helpful what you've said, both of you, about the holistic approach. So there's indicators, but obviously other factors too, and that is right. But this is not a criticism, but there is a lot of feedback locally that it feels like the goalposts are moving and people don't know if restrictions and measures are getting time to bed in. So I just wonder if you can say more about that so people can better understand, although you said you don't put certain weight on certain factors, but for example, in Lanarkshire, demographics, pressure on the NHS, are these factors that are weighing heavily on your mind at the moment?
Oh, yes. You can take that as read. These things weigh heavily on our minds. I'm going to hand over to Gregor in a second, who'll you know, give more insight into this as Chief Medical Officer and obviously somebody who knows Lanarkshire very well too. Couple of things I would say, I don't, and I appreciate why people sometimes get this impression, I am not, when I stand up and say things every day, it's not me hinting, we've taken a decision secretly and we're going to tell you in a few days. I'm just trying to be open about the factors we're taking account of, and I appreciate that can sometimes lead to speculation that we're on a certain track and you know that a certain outcome is inevitable. That's not the case. We genuinely have to assess these things on a regular basis. I can take you through later, if you want, the decision-making process and the timing of that from now through to next Tuesday, when we'll do the first review of the allocation of levels. The second point I'd make is I understand that people feel there is a sense of changing goalposts. And again, this is part of what I need to try to develop and continue to develop an understanding of. That is inherent and inevitable in the situation we face. This is an infectious virus. It will, you know, try to spread and transmit itself in whatever way we can. So we have to be, you know, tactically smarter than that. And therefore that means sometimes us having to change approach and do things that seem as if we're changing the goalposts. But that is a much better position, although it's difficult for the public to be in than standing, you know, rigidly in one position when you're dealing with the opponent that we are just now. And you know, we have to look at the indicators. So in terms of the daily consideration of Lanarkshire, there is nothing since last Thursday that has led us so far to change that judgment that it should be in level three. But we will be looking at, not just in Lanarkshire, but across the whole country, we have to look at not just is the current level of intervention in any area sufficient to stabilise the situation, but is it sufficient to significantly improve the situation? And this is a point that you will hear us talk a lot about in the coming days, probably the coming weeks. If we were to, which we think as of now, I've not seen today's statistics yet, they'll probably come while I'm in this meeting, but looking up to yesterday, we can probably look at our statistics and say we've kind of stabilised things at the moment, but we've stabilised them at a pretty high level, and that is not a good position to go deeper into winter with. And I use the analogy of the summer. Why are we right now, and I don't say this with any sense of, you know, boasting or complacency, that's not the point I'm trying to make. Why right now are we in a relatively better position than other parts of the UK? We took action at slightly different points, but partly it's because we did suppress so low over the summer. So the increased R number in the last few weeks has been operating on a much lower baseline of infection. So it has not risen as far and as fast as it would have done if it had been a higher baseline. That's our risk in the summer, the winter. We might stabilise things, but at a high level, so that we are very much at risk of a very small increase in the R number, which could happen in the winter because people are inside more. It really starting to have it run out of control, and that is a key consideration for us in the decisions we'll take over the next few days. But Gregor can amplify and expand.
Thanks. So I'm going to start this by saying that the arrival of a wholly new infectious disease with a significant mortality to a population that has no previous exposure to that and therefore no immunity to that means that there's no harm-free way of dealing with that. And that's the first starting point. And so every decision that we take, whether that be on a local level or whether that be on a national level, balances up the risks that are posed by any particular path that we take. And that's been the case in some of the decisions that we've made with local authorities and in the discussions in relation to Lanarkshire. And in Lanarkshire, it's probably an important thing just to pause at this point in time and pay tribute to the work of not only the local public health teams across the country in relation to the way that they're tackling the arrival of this virus, but also the work of the National IMT led by Public Health Scotland in terms of providing advice in the background. And they are constantly looking and revising and identifying new sources of data that give us more information about the progress of this disease through our society. In the considerations that we had with Lanarkshire, one of the really important factors that influenced that was that we were seeing signs of progress. And therefore, when we start to consider the balance of harms in that context, it's important that we make decisions that are proportionate to the risks that population faced at this time. And the judgment, the considered judgment, using all the data that was available, was that actually the progress that was being made, we could continue to keep a watching brief and make sure that we didn't become disproportionate in terms of the unintended harms that would be caused both to the society and the way that we, the cohesiveness of society and the way that we interact with each other, but also on the local economy as well. These are decisions that we continually face when posed with these conundrums with the data. Now, since we've made that decision, I've continued to see encouraging signs that the epidemiology within Lanarkshire is improving. But as the First Minister has already outlined, it's not enough just for it to stabilise and to show those signs of improvement. We really need to make sure, as we approach the deeper winter period, is that we've taken those levels of disease and infection down to a low enough level that if we were to start to see an increase in the rate of growth again, that it didn't overwhelm those local services. So I'm encouraged, I'm cautious, but we need to continue to review this, because my experience of dealing with this virus over the last 9 months has been you cannot afford to relax your guard at any point in time, because the way that this virus can respond very, very quickly, as we've seen across Europe, means we need to be continually monitoring things.
Thank you. I suppose then my further question to that is to go back to what the First Minister said in opening remarks. You said it's not sufficient to arrest a deterioration, that we would need to see significant decline. So that goes back to my first question about, are the goalposts moving? So take people in Lanarkshire or Greater Glasgow and Clyde. You know, we think that seeing case numbers come down over 7 days is a good sign of progress. But what does significant decline look like to you and the team, First Minister? What would you need to see over the next couple of days to avoid Lanarkshire, for example, going into level four?
This is where it gets difficult. I appreciate it gets difficult for politicians scrutinising this as well as for the public. There is no sort of straightforward, simple answer to that. So we've tried to set out here, and you know, I think we've done this with greater detail and transparency than many other countries have. So at each level, what we published last week sets out the broad indicators. So, you know, in terms of cases per 100,000 for an area to move from level three to level two, you know, there is a significant level three would be looking broadly at 150 to 300 cases per 100,000 over 7 days. At level two, that's, you know, 75 to 150. So we want to see areas within those thresholds. But it is also important to understand, if an area looks on the face of it to be in those thresholds, is it sustainably in those thresholds, or and is it continuing on a downward trajectory? I don't want to go into detail today, but I've looked at data in the last couple of days that show some areas would look to still be in the thresholds of one of the lower levels, but they started to increase a little bit again. So that's a factor. And sustainability, you know, is it over 1 7-day period, or have we seen that over more than 1 7-day period? The thing about the levels, which I know everybody understands, but it's worth saying, is the move from one level to another is not a neutral act. If you take an area down a level, for example, you open up more, and therefore you are going to increase transmission. So the judgment has to be, has that area got to a low enough and sustainably low enough level to cope with that level of increased transmission? And I guess with Lanarkshire, I don't want to go too deeply into a decision that hasn't been taken yet, but I don't think it will surprise anybody to hear that I wouldn't expect next Tuesday the decision about Lanarkshire to be, will it go from level three to level two? It will be, will it stay in level three, or will it go to level four? And I guess that will come to a judgment of, do we see cases continue to decline? Do we think that is a significant enough decline? And the pressure on NHS, is that, you know, a level that doesn't give us immediate worries about that being breached? So these are fine judgments, and we try to explain them within the data, but within the broader context as well as we can.
Thank you. You explained that you're taking a holistic approach, can't get my words out, a holistic approach to all of this. We haven't talked about schools yet. I think, like many people, I feel really torn on the issue. I declared an interest as a parent of a 14-year-old. But if we look at what happened in August, when the schools went back, the positivity rate and the positive cases, it went up. We get, I think we all do, get almost daily updates from local authorities about outbreaks in schools and the numbers of both pupils and school staff who are self-isolating. What are you going to do about schools? Are they untouchable, or is there more that can be done both to enhance measures in schools, but are you thinking about, are you actively thinking about possibly extending the school break over the Christmas and New Year period? That didn't happen in October, and is that something that you regret?
No, I don't regret that, because I have not seen any evidence that that has had a particular impact on our broader, more general picture of transmission. Gregor will want to say a bit more about the science and the evidence on transmission in schools and amongst younger people. Broadly speaking, and I'm generalising here, Gregor can correct me if I'm stating this in any way too simplistically or erroneously, but the concern about transmission in schools is that it is reflective of wider community transmission. It is not a concern about transmission in schools, it's about what is happening in the wider community and the inevitability of that impacting on schools. Can I say, and I'm always conscious that things I say will get interpreted in 100 different ways, or certainly more than one way. Nothing, in the context we are dealing with just now, nothing's untouchable, because you can't have that position. I can't sit here and say, come what may, we will not do X, or come what may, we will do Y. That would take us into that inflexible position that I just don't think is sensible to have, given what we are dealing with. But with schools, it is where I think the balance of harms comes most into focus. The more you have schools impacted and the school experience of young people impacted, the more you are doing harm to young people through the lack of proper normal educational provision and social interaction with peers and friends and wider networks. And our judgment at the moment is that is a greater harm than the harm having schools is doing in terms of the wider picture of transmission. Now, that does not mean for a single second that we are not concerned about or in any way blasé about safety in schools. And by that, I don't just mean young people, obviously teachers and those who work in schools, which is why we keep the mitigation measures in schools under review and have changed the guidance on face coverings very recently as an example of how that is the case, and continue to discuss with teaching unions, with local authorities, with parents about the right balance there. But I am firmly of the view, and I think this is increasingly reflected in other countries, including countries going back into very strict lockdowns, that if at all possible, our objective should be to keep schools open, because I think that is in the interests of young people. And we will try to do that as far as possible. And that the price of that may be at times greater restrictions on the rest of the population to facilitate and enable that. And I think that's a trade-off that most people would think is worth making if we can possibly keep schools open.
So thank you. I'm going to approach your question from two slightly different angles as I answer. And first of all, is to fall back on the science, what the science tells us about transmission across age groups. And we know from the evidence collated internationally that transmission becomes more common between people as you grow older through older age groups. That's not just about children, that's through to adulthood as well. We can say with a high degree of confidence that transmission between children of young ages, particularly primary school age, is very unusual. And transmission from children to adults in that age group is similarly very unusual. As children grow older, as they start to get towards the latter stages of secondary school, we start to see more evidence that transmission occurs between those young people and from young people to adults. But again, it is not as great as between adult to adult. So there's a gradient of risk in terms of transmission. And again, when we go back to examining any cases that we've had that are associated with schools, and I'm using language very, very carefully here, the most common feature that we see is that those transmissions have occurred outside the school environment. So they tended to occur either through social events that have taken place outside school or within family or households as well. And we know from experience and international evidence, again, that those are the most common places for transmission to take place as well. So the risk is being mitigated by the actions that have been put in place across schools to make sure that where we see there are perhaps other considerations, that transmission perhaps is more likely, that, for instance, face coverings are recommended and being worn in environments where transmission may become more likely. And that's important because the UK CMOs have also together released a consensus statement which was about the importance of schooling at this period in time. We produced that a couple of months ago. It's available and I can share that with you if you wish. But it recognises, and this is really important, the public health benefit. So this is distinct from any educational benefit, but the public health benefit of continuing schooling for children. Because we know that creating any disadvantage through education at that age has a detrimental effect throughout those children carry throughout their life as well. And so protecting schooling and the education system as much as is possible and is feasible is on public health grounds a really desirable goal as well, separate from even trying to control the virus.
Thank you, Dr. Smith and First Minister. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. Our next questions come from Beatrice Wishart, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, First Minister, Dr. Smith and colleagues. I think most people accepted the COVID restrictions and understood that it would help create breathing space across the summer. And First Minister, you've mentioned the actions taken in the summer and its impact on the position that we're now in. Some problems were foreseen and some progress was lost, and there were critical moments and critical movements like the students in September. Given that we're coming up to Christmas, the end of the university term, and people will want to be with their families after an extremely difficult year, I wonder what progress has been made in terms of the request for a Four Nations Summit, which some of my Liberal Democrat colleagues have asked for, to help communication and travel and family spread across the UK over the Christmas period.
Beatrice, I'm not sure exactly what you're referring to in terms of a Four Nations Summit. I participated in a COBRA meeting on Monday of this week, if memory serves me correctly, about days. And we have Four Nations discussions, perhaps not as regularly as I would like, but we do have Four Nations discussions. We had one on Saturday, the COBRA meeting on Monday. One of the things that was agreed between the Four Nations on Monday was that we would try to reach a common position around Christmas generally, and within that, obviously, the position around students. I think all of us would inject a caveat, which is difficult for people, I know, given how fast Christmas approaches, that we simply cannot say with certainty right now what the position will be at Christmas and therefore what will be possible and what will not. What we do know with some certainty is that the more we drive the virus down now, the more potential there might be for not 100% normality, but a greater degree of normality by the time we get to the Christmas period. And we can't guarantee that the position will be consistent across the UK, and therefore I guess we can't guarantee that the rules in place will be absolutely identical in each part of the UK, but there is a commitment to try to get as much consistency as we possibly can. And that includes on universities and student movements. We are, as we've said before, although we haven't reached final decisions, because unfortunately it is premature to do that, but we are looking at a range of different options to allow students to be able to go home at Christmas, but then to mitigate both the risks of them taking the virus to different parts of the country and also the risks of sparking transmission if students come back in great numbers. And, you know, the kind of things that are under discussion, which we've set out before, are staggered end points to the term this side of Christmas, how we use testing to facilitate the return of students, what you would be advising students in terms of behaviour and potential isolation before going home and when they got home, and also then what the balance between in-person and blended learning might be at the start of the new term to mitigate the risks of transmission then. So we are looking closely at all of that, and we are trying and will continue to try to reach as much, for obvious reasons, reach as much consistency in our decisions as we can across the four nations.
Thank you. I'm sorry I wasn't clearer in my question. I was trying to get to the sort of plans and protections in place before people start to move around. I wonder if I could move on to restrictions and the impact on, or the disproportionate impacts on certain groups, such as those on low-income women, young people and minority ethnic groups. So I wondered what consultation has taken place in terms of the framework with those groups.
In terms of consultation, we try to keep up a regular dialogue across different parts of government with stakeholders in all areas. As we develop the levels approach and the strategic framework, obviously we want to strengthen that consultation as we go. Inevitably, and I think this is just a statement of the obvious, often consultation in the days leading up to particular decisions will be most intense with the groups and sectors likely to be most immediately and directly impacted by those decisions. And, you know, an example of that in recent times will be across certain sectors of the economy, hospitality, for example. But we are seeking to develop that consultation more systematically, although my colleagues across government have regular ongoing dialogue with stakeholders. What we do have is, and I think this is published already in terms of the edition of this that would have informed last week's decisions, we have, so the public health advice comes through our national incident management team, in terms of what parts of the country go into what levels, driven by the data and the judgments we've spoken about. We then have what we call a four harms advisory part of the decision-making process, which is, you know, chief advisors across government looking at the wider harms. So we have there a range of indicators and data across these different harms. So we've talked already about the indicators that we look at in terms of the direct health harm of the virus, but we also look at indirect health harm. So we look at data on, you know, for example, A&E attendances, excess deaths, you know, people avoiding GPs or hospitals. We look then at societal harms. So we would look at education data, welfare fund applications to give a sense of the sort of poverty impact. We look at crime data. We look at survey data around loneliness. And then a range of economic harm impacts, GDP, employment statistics, the advice of the chief economist. So all of that is taken account of as we try to come to a balanced decision. The four harms, of course, although they are all important, we should never lose sight of the fact that they are all influenced, yes, by the measures we take to control the virus, but they will all be exacerbated if we don't control the virus. So that imperative of controlling the virus always has to be absolutely at the top of our thinking and objectives.
Now, thank you. That reference to isolation and loneliness leads me to turn to the situation in the Northern Isles. And I guess I want to understand a bit more about the, you know, what's been put into practice, because there have been some concerns that solutions to central belt problems appear to be copy and pasted into the islands. And the convener touched on this in his opening questions. The Shetland Islands Council political leader said last week that the announcements last week had a, quote, urban-centric view. So what's the evidence base for adding additional measures to levels? And does this risk undermining public compliance with restrictions? And I'm thinking of areas that are particularly rural and remote in island populations like Orkney and Shetland.
I'll ask the CMO to say a bit about the decision to continue with the household restriction, even for the areas at level one. The levels approach is an attempt to tackle this virus and do what we need to do to tackle it without a one-size-fits-all approach. Because in any country, if you have a one-size-fits-all approach, it's the approach that is necessary for the most highly populated areas that will end up to a greater or lesser extent driving things. So the levels approach is an attempt to, as far as we can, avoid that and have a proportionate targeted approach that takes account of the circumstances in different parts of the country with different demographics, different geographies, and therefore different risks of the virus transmitting. So if we were taking right now an urban-centred approach, Shetland would still be in level 2 or 3, because that would be what is necessary for the central belt and other populated parts of the country. It's not, it's in level 1. But, and here's the but, there is no corner of Scotland and there is no corner of the globe right now that is immune, if that's not a sort of dodgy phrase to use when we're talking about a virus, but that is exempt from the risk of this virus. There have been cases in Shetland. I think there may have been a case in Shetland in the last couple of days. So we have to be cautious and very precautionary, even in the parts of the country where we deem the risk to be relatively low compared to other parts of the country. And when we lift restrictions, we are, you know, this is not, it's not a case of we get the virus down, we lift restrictions and everything else is equal. Lifting restrictions is not a neutral act as far as the transmission of the virus is concerned. It creates more opportunities for the virus to spread. So we've got to do that cautiously. We've got to make sure that as we do that, we're not immediately going to trigger something. So often the decision will be to do it incrementally and not make all of the changes at once. And we know that the biggest risk of transmission is inside people's houses. When people are less likely, and we can all identify with this, less likely to abide by social distancing, less likely to have the kind of ventilation you need to minimise the risk, and more likely to be taking part in all the human behaviours that, unfortunately, the virus thrives on. So that's why we've decided to be a bit cautious when we're taking an area down to level 1. That involves opening up of hospitality, for example. So the cautious view was, let's just keep an extra precaution initially to make sure that we're not immediately putting an area at risk of going straight back into level 2. So it is just about caution and precaution and trying to deal with this as carefully as possible. But Gregor can say a bit more about that particular decision, which obviously has public health backing.
Thank you. That precautionary approach, the principles that we've used to try to tackle this virus is absolutely essential. And we're reminded of it by the public health community across Scotland continually, that the need for caution, particularly when we move down levels and start to reduce the level of restrictions that we place upon society, is absolutely necessary. And I've mentioned the role of the National IMT before in the evidence I've given to you, and again here, the role of the National IMT was very, very important. The feedback from the directors of public health associated with the Northern Isles was critical in forming the judgment as to how to apply the current measures that are associated with level one. And as we start to allow society to come back together, as we start to increase the number of opportunities that people have to interact with each other again, the very real risk is that we introduce additional new ways of transmission. And there was a very strong view held not only by Orkney and Shetland, but by other rural regions of Scotland as well, is that moving too quickly, too fast, was just too great a risk just now in terms of allowing the virus to re-emerge quickly across these places. So we've committed to reviewing that and keeping that under review. We continue to liaise with the health protection teams in those areas. The other aspect, which I think is very important for these areas, is the contribution that travel into these areas makes, particularly from areas of the country where they are experiencing a higher level of disease. And again, those health protection teams have asked us very, very clearly to assist them in trying to reduce the risk of introduction of new disease, importation of cases into their areas at this point in time.
Turn now to Annabel Ewing for her question. She also joins us remotely.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, First Minister and Dr. Smith. I have a few questions I'd like to direct in the first instance to the First Minister, and it's dealing with the issue of economic harm. And over the last days, we have seen a lot of to-ing and fro-ing, I think is one way of putting it, about the lack of clarity as to the application or otherwise of the 80% furlough offer to England when it goes into lockdown on Thursday. And I just wonder if the First Minister could update us as to where matters currently stand. Thank you.
Matters currently stand right now, unless there's been any development since I joined this committee session this morning, exactly where they stood last night. We have a commitment on the face of it from the Prime Minister that the extended furlough, the 80% furlough that is in place for November as a result of England's lockdown will continue for other parts of the UK beyond that, should it be necessary. That's how the Prime Minister's commitment was interpreted, but the words 80% have never been used, as far as I can see, by any UK government minister so far. So that's the detail that we need to press. If you look at the Prime Minister's statement, like many statements that I'm sure it could be said about statements I make from time to time, it's capable of a number of different interpretations. I don't have it in front of me exactly, but the most minimum it said, Scotland will continue to get the benefit of a furlough scheme. Well, that bit was never in doubt. We've always known there would be a continuation, a replacement for the existing furlough. The key thing is what terms that is on. Is that on the eligibility criteria that will be in place for November? And at 80%, and that bit is really crucial, and we do not yet have clarity from the Treasury on that. And it's really important that we get that clarity, because it is important for planning purposes, but frankly, it's really important for individuals across the country who are worried about their jobs and their wages. I mean, if you take somebody on the national living wage, for example, the difference between 80% and 67% is significant. It's it's almost £200 a month. These are real issues for people. So I'm hoping the clarity will come in the course of today. But then, if I'd been sitting here yesterday morning, I would have said I hoped it would come in the course of yesterday, and it didn't. But I live in hope.
Thank you for your answer, First Minister. I mean, it's very disappointing, I think is one way of putting it, that in the midst of a global pandemic, this is the way the UK government is treating with the Scottish government. I mean, why do you think they won't just confirm in writing what the position is? I mean, would that not be quite a straightforward thing with their army of Treasury officials to do?
Yes, and hopefully that's what we will get to. I mean, I guess the Treasury is always cautious about committing to things that will cost them more money. But there's an issue of fairness here. And we obviously were sitting here in the Scottish Parliament, so inevitably our focus is on Scotland. This is not just about Scotland. This is about fairness for Manchester. Manchester in the last few weeks have had to, scrabble and argue over money to support lockdown measures. So it's an issue for fairness for parts of the north of England that have had restrictions in place for some time. It's about Wales, it's about Northern Ireland, and it's about Scotland. It's about a principle that says you can't just have generous financial support for lockdowns when there are lockdowns required by the south of England. You have to have the same level playing field in financial support for whatever part of the UK requires to have these restrictions. That's, I think, the principle of that appears now to be agreed with by the UK government. We just now need to see the detail of that. I The situation we're all dealing with right now is complicated enough without adding to the complication by governments in different parts of the UK having to worry about whether they're having to fit their public health decisions into a window of availability for finance. That's just, you know, it would be a crazy way to start to have to operate. So hopefully we can get the certainty that whatever we need to do, whenever we need to do it, there is a level playing field of financial support available. And I hope that detail comes soon.
I thank the First Minister that further answer. In terms of other financial issues, of course, it's not just the furlough scheme. There's also issues to do with Barnett consequentials and indeed financial guarantees for demand-led financial support, in particular to businesses. What progress is being made on those fronts in terms of getting clarity that would be, of course, of pivotal importance in being able the Scottish Government being able to take the best decisions at the right time?
So this is the second financial issue that we're seeking clarity on from the Treasury, and I am hopeful we will get this. Whether that clarity is exactly what we're looking for or not remains to be seen, but I'm hopeful we will get clarity over the next couple of days. Certainly at the COBRA meeting on Monday, there seemed to be an agreement by the Chief Secretary to the Treasury that a reconciliation of the sort of Barnett consequential position, which was due at the end of November, would be brought forward to the start of November. So that's progress. Effectively, how the Treasury, and can I preface this comment by saying the support that has come through the Treasury has been very welcome. I'm not quibbling with that. They hold the borrowing powers. We have to depend on them, therefore, for financial interventions. And there has been significant support provided, and that is good and positive. And I also accept that we're in unprecedented times, so the ways in which things are being done right now are not necessarily how they are usually done. And I accept all of that. But what has happened up until now is the Treasury has... the UK government have made certain decisions and the Treasury has said, well, here's some guaranteed consequentials for the Scottish government and for the other devolved administrations. And you have to kind of pay for everything out of that until we say it's run out and we'll give you more. But they haven't been telling us exactly what we're expected to pay out of that. So the last allocation of consequentials was £700 million for the Scottish government. But that was before the more recent UK government announcements about business support and about lockdown. So what we need to know is, what's that £700 million meant to cover? Because it can't possibly cover the subsequent announcements that flow through into potential decisions for the Scottish government. And we're waiting to get that allocation, that reconciliation, and any decisions about additional support. The other issue here is, and we're not going to fix this over the next couple of days. What we have right now is, if you take the decisions of the UK government on business support, which are, I think, the right decisions, any business for as long as necessary that has to shut down or have its trade restricted gets this level of grant. That's an open-ended, demand-led commitment. Mm-hmm. And the Treasury is able to give that because they can borrow the money to pay for it. We obviously want our businesses to have the same open-ended demand-led commitment, but Barnett doesn't allow us to do that because Barnett gives us finite resources that we have to live within. So the Barnett formula is not ideal for dealing with this kind of expenditure. And that, is something that perhaps we need to fix in longer term. But in the immediate sense, that problem would at least be mitigated if we had a significant additional commitment to resources. Because right now, we're sitting with £700 million that's meant to pay for all the commitments pre the most recent ones and, on the face of it, all of the most recent commitments that have been made, which is not a sustainable position. But anyway, I hope that moves on in the next couple of days.
Well, thank you, First Minister. I just hope the UK Treasury is maybe listening to this and about to put pen to paper. Thank you. Thank you, Computer.
Thank you, Annabel. Can I turn next to Mark Ruskell for his questions?
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and good morning to you both. I'd like to start by asking you about the case for mass testing of an entire population, regardless of whether people have symptoms or not. Now, Slovakia did this last week. In Liverpool, the entire population is being tested as well. You spoke earlier about Lanarkshire and about the situation where an area could move up to level four. Would it be desirable, if an area is moving to level four, to test the entire population in that area? And would it be achievable, given the concerns that exist around the lighthouse system?
You got to, at the end there, a sort of distinction that I was going to start with, which is the distinction between desirability and efficacy and achievability. I would put the lighthouse system to one side on this, because if mass testing, Gregor can talk a lot more knowledgeably about the technologies here than I can, but if mass testing, which I think is desirable to get to as an objective, is going to be achievable, I don't think it's going to be done through the PCR testing, which, you know, are the tests that are done, then go to the labs and take, you know, at best, you know, 24 hours, but sometimes longer than that for people to get the results. Mass testing is going to be achieved through the different, you know, rapid testing technologies that are part of the trial in Liverpool. So the lateral flow devices that are being used there, some of the other technology that is about point of test results effectively. Now, the limitations there at the moment are not just in terms of the logistics of that, the access to the tests and the volumes you would need and the logistics of delivery of that. It is, and this is a bit, I'll leave Gregor to go into more detail on, it's just about some of the developing scientific opinion around that. I couldn't sit here and tell you right now that for one of these rapid tests, how often you would have to do it to give people assurance, because it would tell you, and there is, I think, some evidence that these tests are not necessarily as reliable as the PCR testing. But if you get tested with one of these, you know, rapid tests today and it tells you you're negative, it tells you nothing about your virus status tomorrow or the day after that. So there's questions about the frequency and making sure that you're not doing something that builds in the wider population a false assurance about what tests are doing and aren't doing. So if you're asking me, I am enthusiastic and we want to move quickly into the realms of mass testing, but there are a number of issues along the way that we have to resolve and understand in order to get from here to there. We are part of discussions UK-wide around the deployment and rollout of this kind of technology, and obviously we're looking very carefully on an ongoing basis at the experience in Liverpool, where the trial is supposedly getting underway later this week.
So my starting point for this is I remain convinced that our way out of dealing with COVID-19 and all the impacts that it has on our society will come from some technological advance, and that might either be the development of an effective vaccine, or it might be the development of reliable, accessible and acceptable testing that we can do at scale. And the developments that we see in Liverpool are interesting, because it represents an opportunity to test some of the theories that lie behind that. We're a little bit off yet of having all the evidence that we need to deploy that at scale in the UK. You gave the example of Slovakia there. My understanding of what they did in Slovakia was actually that it was serology-based antibody testing rather than diagnostic testing that they were doing in that country, which is a completely different thing for a different purpose. But in terms of identifying people who have infection that are previously unidentified, mass testing is something which may in the future allow us to more quickly identify people who carry infection and isolate them so that we can break those chains of transmission at an earlier point in time. At this moment in time, however, the technology that's available to us is yet unproven in that regard. We need to develop a consensus in the evidence base that tells us how often we should test those populations that you speak about. The tests that we use, particularly when it's asymptomatic testing that we're doing, unfortunately have a much lower degree of sensitivity than the current PCR tests that we've all become familiar with. So whilst the specificity of these tests are very high, so the chances of you having a positive result and it not being COVID and it actually being something else are almost non-existent, that there is a much lower level of confidence in the sensitivity of identifying individuals who have COVID disease, and they probably operate best just now between 50 and 60% sensitivity. So we need some improvement in that technology still, and we need further evidence in terms of the frequency of testing that would be most useful to make sure that we're identifying those cases. The other aspect of testing, which the First Minister's already identified there, which is important, is of course testing any individual tells you whether they are positive at that point in time, whether they're carrying the disease at that point in time. With a prolonged incubation of up to 14 days that we see with COVID-19, one of the continual challenges that we face is, of course, that people can be in the early stages of incubating the disease and still go on and develop it, but test negative if they're not tested at the right time.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I've heard you over the last eight months, First Minister, talk a lot about your concerns about testing and the kind of false assurance, as you just put it. But, you know, you're the First Minister. You offer guidance to people every week on the television through press conferences. If you said to people, yes, we're doing mass testing, if you get a negative test, you still need to stick to facts, you still need to stick to the restrictions in your area. Do you not think people would listen to you?
People listen, but that your question presupposes that we have the logistics and the availability of these tests and the confidence scientifically in them to do it. And the only thing holding us back is my worry about false assurance. That would not be an accurate characterization. Okay. One of the big things is what is it you are saying to people that a test signifies? So, you know, Gregor told me something I didn't know there about the Slovakia being antibody testing. You know, antibody testing, which a few months back is what people used to talk about as the great hope, and maybe it still will be at some point. But right now, you can't tell anybody with any degree of assurance what a positive antibody test means in terms of your protection in the future. And similarly, with one of these rapid tests, you know, you get one today and it's negative. Well, when should you get another one in order to know you're still negative? So, yes, I think people, to a greater or lesser extent, will listen to these messages they have throughout the past 8 months. But for somebody like me to ask people to trust the messages we're given, we've got to have a reasonable degree of kind of scientific, if not certainty, then confidence in the purpose and the results that we're telling people to rest on. One other point I would make, I have no ideological position on many of these things, apart from maybe the kind of whole herd immunity arguments. I would love nothing more than to be sitting here and saying, here's the big shiny technological solution that is just there and it fixes all of this. I'm desperate for that, as desperate as anybody is for that. But we've got to pursue that as vigorously as we can. But as we're doing that, we've got to focus on the here and now and making sure the testing we do have available is working as extensively as we can get it to work and as efficiently as we can get it to work. Now, I'm going to sit here and perhaps betray a little bit of political cynicism. But I think if you were to map, I'm not knocking the Liverpool pilot. I think it's really good and positive and we will hopefully learn a lot from it. But I think if you were to map the correlation between when our colleagues in the UK government start to point at shiny new, you know, technological pilots, and when their current testing programme was maybe coming under question and stress and strain, you would find quite a close correlation. So let's pursue the technological advances. They are, as Gregor said, probably they are in some way, shape or form the way out of this for us, but let's not lose sight of what we need to do in the here and now with the technology we have available for us.
Okay. You are, though, I mean, you hinted earlier on that testing among certain groups, such as students, was something that you're considering. I'm wondering if there are other groups that need to be considered in that as well. So multi-generational households, for example, we know there are medical studies that show that there's increased possibility of transmission where you have multiple generations living together, particularly young adults, and that can increase the risk of death of older people. Is there a case for testing those groups who are particularly impacted by poverty, living in cramped conditions,
Should there be guidance for those people living in those kind of settings, or should there be testing?
You can make a case, and it will be a stronger or weaker case depending on the group you're talking about. You can make a case for expanding testing to probably almost every group in the population. What we have to do, with the best will in the world, you are going to have a finite testing capacity. It's a much bigger finite capacity now than it used to be in Scotland, and it's still growing, but we can't escape questions of how we prioritise the capacity we have, and therefore we need to do that in a way that is clinically driven, which is what our testing strategy does, which is very much about focusing on symptomatic people. And we expect, as we go through winter, the demand for that will rise as people have other potentially other viruses that may present with the same symptoms as COVID. You then look at how you use testing to protect vulnerable groups. So we've prioritised care homes and testing staff in care homes. We are going beyond that now with other people going in and out of care homes. In the NHS, how you protect groups through targeted testing of patients and staff there. And then, yes, you use testing to try to learn about or control outbreaks, and tactically in other. So you can make a case for extending that in all sorts of ways. What I have to take account of is the clinical advice that says what the prioritisation of that might be. That's talking still within the PCR model of testing. As we do see the development and the greater deployment of the new technologies, your flexibility becomes greater there to take tests to people and get very rapid tests that allow you to do things differently. And I think that's where the genuinely really interesting and exciting developments come from. I suppose all through this, I have never questioned in my own mind or publicly the central importance of testing in all of this. I always have and continue to get a little bit nervous when I hear people talking about tests as if it's somehow, a test is somehow equivalent to a vaccine, that you get a test and suddenly you're, and I know you're not doing
that.
I know you're not doing that, but you do sometimes hear, and I understand the sentiment. We all want to have the magic solution to this virus. Testing's hugely important, but we have to be mindful of how we're using it, the prioritisation of it, and the tactics and where it fits into a broader strategy. Because even with PCR testing, you get a negative test one day, it cannot give you assurance for, you know, the next day or the next week that you're negative or that you're not at risk of the virus. So these fundamental messages about how you avoid getting and transmitting the virus remain the most important foundational messages that we have and need to continue to deploy.
Okay. Finally, if I could just turn to one other topic, and that's the self-isolation support grants. I mean, obviously, these are very welcome. They're available for people who are on benefits, but they're not available for those other people who are not on benefits, but nevertheless are on low incomes or insecure work. Now, I was contacted by a social enterprise in Stirling. They pay the living wage, and they wrote to me, and they said that they'd love to pay full sick pay, but the economic conditions over the last 15 years have never allowed this. Currently, they have one to two staff members that would qualify, but almost every member would find themselves in financial difficulty if they had to self-isolate, as they'd only get £95 a week statutory sick pay. And they're saying that, you know, this creates an incentive for those on low income whose work can't be done from home to come into work, hide symptoms in order to pay rent and feed families. Now, that's coming from an employer. And I'm just wondering, like, is there the potential to evolve this payment on a bit, to remove some of the conditions which are currently probably causing a delay in people actually applying for it, because you've got to prove eligibility? Is there a case to move it towards a less conditional or even an unconditional payment to make sure that people are able financially to do the right thing and to self-isolate?
Yes, there is a case, and we will continue to try to do that. What I can't do is change a finite budget into an infinite budget that can spread in all directions. I genuinely wish I could. So some of our decisions here, and I'm not sitting here using this as an excuse, just a statement of reality, are constrained by the availability of finance. And, you know, we have, in terms of the self-isolation payment, we have tried to deliver that in a way that is going to be as quick and efficient with as little bureaucracy as possible. So doing it through the welfare fund arrangements was the way to do that. Yes, it has qualifying criterion around benefits, but we've tried to build some flexibility into that if there are particular cases that don't fit the requirements. And you know, we've also made it available to people without recourse to public funds. But yes, I think if there is if there is one thing in terms of the financial support we're given, obviously I'd like us to be able to give more support to businesses that are affected, but more support for self-isolation, absolutely, I think is a priority, because that is going to continue to be such a key compliance issue in terms of the overall battle against COVID. So we continue to have these discussions with the UK, both in terms of levels of statutory sick pay and overall provision of a financial envelope that allows us to advance that more. But even within our own resources, we will continue to explore all options to give people the support they need to do what is a really difficult thing.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. The next questions come from Shona Robertson, who joins us remotely.
Good morning. I have a couple of questions about Dundee, but just before I come on to that, I want to pick up something from the exchange with Annabel Ewing earlier on. You said, I think to paraphrase, it would, you know, be outrageous to have to fit public health decisions into a kind of financial framework set elsewhere. How much has the Scottish Government had to plan for that scenario? And given how outrageous that would be, what kind of communication and united front, if you like, has there been with the other devolved nations in lobbying the Treasury around this, and indeed with the English regions? Can you give us a flavour of how much communication has been going on behind the scenes around that?
A lot, and you know, I know the Welsh Government have very strong views on this as well. Northern Ireland, I mean, I'll leave these administrations to speak for themselves, but we try across the devolved nations to you know, coordinate our approaches on these things as much as possible, on the basis that we hope the three of us might be listened to more than just one of us on our own. It doesn't always work out like that, but we try to maximise that approach. And Wales, obviously Wales is in its firebreak right now, and at the start of that, the First Minister of Wales actually called on the Treasury to extend some furlough support and was turned down. Manchester had its struggles a couple of weeks ago. So there is a sense of inequity there and a sense of unfairness that I think we all feel that, and this is not about, I think the decision at the weekend to extend furlough over the period of the English lockdown is the right one. I don't grudge anybody in England a penny of the support that they are rightly getting. But the sense of unfairness is that that decision has only been made when it was necessary for all of England to go into lockdown, and when when parts of England or other parts of the UK have faced these situations, there has been no willingness to be flexible. And that, I think, is the position that cannot continue. So there's a lot of common ground between the devolved administrations, and we will try together as well as individually to press that case.
Okay, thank you for that. To move on to Dundee, obviously having moved to level three, and going back to some of the decision making around that, clearly the issue of the concerns about hospital beds being overwhelmed within 6 weeks was highlighted. But there was also this notion of, you know, there was an early indication of a blunting of indicators. So my first question is, are you able to say whether that blunting has continued as a trend for Dundee, and has the pressure on hospital beds increased or lessened? And going on to this idea as well about, you know, the indicators are not automatic triggers. So from that, I take it from your previous answer, I think it was to Monica Lennon, that, you know, you would need to see a trend that you know, otherwise you might have a city or an area going up and down the levels if that wasn't sustainable. So I guess, what would you need to see for Dundee for that to be a sustainable change in the right direction?
I think Gregor will want to say more about this. I'm, I won't comment too much on the more recent trends. The decision-making process we have is, over the course of today and tomorrow, we will look at some of the more up-to-date indicators, and then that will feed into a decision-making process over the next couple of days. I'd say a couple of things in general terms, and please accept that these are general comments and shouldn't necessarily be taken as comments on any particular area. But although this levels allocation is something we will review weekly, I would not expect very often, if ever, a part of the country to go into one level 1 week and that to change the following week, because we need to have a longer period than that for us to be certain that restrictions are having an effect and that things are hopefully going in the right direction. So without preempting decisions, I would be very surprised, and Gregor may be about to tell you something completely different, but I would doubt it. I would be very surprised if Dundee was to move out of level three after just a week in level three. When we made the decision last week, the cases per 100,000 in Dundee were 185. Test positivity was over 8%. So obviously that on both of these put it quite firmly in the level three sort of box. In order for, level two to sort of open up again, you'd need to see a significant reduction in the both of those indicators, as well as the overall situation. And we would want to make sure that that was a reduction that was sustainable and a direction of travel that was going to be sustained. Now, hopefully we will see, when we look at the indicators later this week, some signs of either stabilisation or hopefully some improvement in Dundee. I can't say that with any certainty right now, but we would need to see that over a slightly longer period before we would safely be able to take the decision to move down a level that would involve a significant opening up and therefore higher risks of transmission. I don't have all of the breakdown of today's figures, but we've got a little bit of an increase in new cases today from the last previous days. Generally over the country, what I don't have yet is what the test positivity of that is, and we have a bit of a spike in number of deaths today, so that all of that will feed into the broader consideration that we have to make over the coming days. Gregor.
Yeah, so the discussions in relation to Dundee City in particular were very detailed. There were prolonged discussions with the local public health teams trying to understand not just the impact within Dundee itself, but some of the surrounding areas and the way that particularly people moved around in those areas as well was also taken into consideration. The test positivity rate for Dundee, as First Minister said, was over 8% at that point in time. I would go back to the answer that I gave in relation to Lanarkshire just now. We are seeing encouraging signs across the country. That's not in every area, but generally across the country, we're seeing encouraging signs of a reduction in the number of cases that are coming through. And we continue to track that on a day-to-day basis in every area across Scotland just now. The projections that we had for Dundee showed that there was likely to be a disproportionate impact, particularly on general hospital admissions, with some potential for quite a significant impact also affecting their ICU beds, not just in the immediate future, but 4 to 6 weeks in advance. And of course, all these measures are designed to try to prevent that likelihood from becoming true. We continue to monitor and track that just now. What we are seeing across Scotland from early compliance data in particular is that people's contacts with other people have reduced, and that's often the first sign that we see that these measures are beginning to work. And we've seen roughly about a 20%, just under 20% drop in people's contacts with other people. That's a positive sign, but it takes 2 to 3 weeks for us to see some of those other signs really starting to filter through in the data that we track. So consolidation and stability is a really important feature of the monitoring process just now. And as I say, I would characterise that as perhaps cautious optimism in some areas, but it's too early yet to be making any decisions based on that.
Okay, thank you. That's all from me, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Shona. Our next questions come from Maurice Corrie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, First Minister. Good morning, Dr. Smith. First Minister, can I ask a question directly? What influence does the views of local leaders actually have in when you come to your decision making?
It has a...
And that can be health and also with council leaders.
I mean, it has a big impact. I mean, you take Lanarkshire. It was very clearly the view of the local Lanarkshire leadership. By that, I mean the two local councils, the health board, NHS Lanarkshire, the police last week, that they were not in any way denying the severity of the situation, but collectively they thought that the restrictions in place and the plans they had were sufficient to keep the area out of level four. And that was, it's not the only factor in the decision we arrived at, but it was a material factor. So, clearly they have an impact. I take the view on this, and it's a view that has been and no doubt will continue to be misinterpreted at times, that we're in a situation just now, not just in Scotland, but globally, where governments are having to take the most horrendous decisions day after day. I wouldn't wish these decisions on anybody right now. And when you're in that position, somebody has to be ultimately responsible and accountable. And, you know, there's a part of me would love that to be a local council leader, because it means it wouldn't be me. But I don't think that's fair. And I don't think that is respecting the overall democratic accountability in the country. So that's why I have taken the view that the buck has to stop with government. We have to be ultimately accountable for the decisions. So the final decisions have to be ours. And I think that's right. It's not control freakery. It's not trying to, carve other people out of decisions. It's just, I think, the right way to operate in a difficult situation. But we listen to a wide spectrum of views, and in that wide spectrum of views, the views of local leaders who know their areas, who know the travel patterns, who know the interactions are absolutely crucial. And we will, continue to make sure that they are an integral part of that decision-making process.
Thank you. Can I ask Dr. Smith the same question in relation to public health?
So I have almost daily contact with public health leaders across Scotland, and we discuss in quite detail through the National IMT framework progress. I think it's very important that I listen to the perspectives of our public health community across Scotland, not just the leaders within that community, but actually from a lot of the people who are doing the work on the ground as well, and trying to maintain that contact is a very important feature. It's also important to factor in how those public health leaders interact with their local health and care systems, and the broader involvement of, you'll be aware of, the local resilience partnerships that exist as well. And you get a real feel from the way that those people collaborate and cooperate at that local level. You get a much greater wealth of information in terms of being able to then apply that to your judgments and decision-making. Again, Lanarkshire is a very good example. We've spoken about that previously, but the level of contact that we have had with the public health leaders within Lanarkshire, getting a real sense of how they feel that they are getting on top of the transmission within their communities, the nuances within those communities, recognising that Lanarkshire is a broad geographical area and that there are different impacts on different parts of Lanarkshire as well. The travel patterns, the intelligence that they give about movement within those areas as well. All these things are factored in. And the last thing I would say that's really, really important is that the public health community, these public health leaders, are our eyes and ears on the ground. Mm-hmm. They're the ones that are interrogating the data. They're the ones that are seeing, from the conversations that they're having with people, the associations that are being developed with places where people are going. And we get intelligence from that as to what are the common associations where people may actually be contracting this virus. And we've used that very proactively through the networks that we have to try and identify what are the more common areas where people may be at risk of coming into contact with other people who are infected.
Thank you. I'm very glad to hear that. Having been a chairman of a health board in Argyll and Bute, I'm delighted to hear you do pay a lot of attention to what the health and social care partnerships do. And thank you for that. Thank you both for your answers on that one. Can I turn to this, to Dr. Smith, in relation to your comment about the paper that the CMOs from UK produced about education and schools and how important it is to keep schools going and keep them together. Does that apply similarly to colleges and universities?
It also has a knock-on effect. I mean, the paper concentrates on primary and secondary education, but I think that there is a lot of what we have said about that which is also transferable to higher education and further education as well. There is overwhelming evidence, even before we were faced with a pandemic like this, that actually education and opportunities through education and employment are one of the things that start to make a real impact for people in reducing health inequalities that exist across our society. So ensuring that we maintain an education process so that we don't detrimentally impact on people's, if you like, life opportunities, subsequently has a huge public health benefit, both immediately but more importantly further down the line as well, both for those people but also their families as well.
Yeah. And that's really emphasised in your paper, is that right, in relation to the
first. So this is one of the things that is recognised within this consensus statement that was produced by the UK CMOs. It also talks about and ensures that we recognise that actually schools act as an environment where, for those children who come from more vulnerable backgrounds as well, it's a point of contact that makes sure that the safeguarding considerations are all taken into effect as well.
Good. Thank you very much. And First Minister, one final question for you, and looking ahead to hopefully blue sky objectives and things, vaccines. What's the government done about its getting its allocation of future vaccines, whatever one might be chosen, whatever? Are you getting your oar in there and making sure it's Scotland standing
very much so
top of that?
We procure vaccines, flu vaccine, and we'll procure COVID vaccines through a UK Four Nations process. So these discussions are well advanced about the allocation of that. We have plans in place, overseen by a programme board, about how we will start to roll out a COVID vaccination programme. There are clearly big uncertainties in that right now. We don't know exactly when a vaccine will be available, and we don't know yet the exact nature of the vaccine that will be available. So will it be a vaccine that, is prioritised firstly on elderly people? How many doses will be required? But the planning for that, insofar as it is possible with all of these uncertainties, is well advanced in Scotland, and the discussions UK-wide are well advanced too. If you want, Gregor might be able to say a little bit more. Absolutely. Just about the prospects for a vaccine at some point over the next wee while.
Yeah, it's another area where I'm optimistic, is that the vaccine development continues. There are dozens of vaccine projects globally, and the United Kingdom has invested quite significant sums of money in a number of our own vaccine projects as well, two of which are showing some early signs of promise and have entered kind of phase three trials just now. We continue to track exactly how those are going, but certainly we're optimistic that they are offering very encouraging signs that vaccines will become available to us. We have already started working through the JCVI, which is the UK body which identifies our approach to vaccines and immunisation. And the JCVI has already given some preliminary advice as to how we should approach the vaccination programme for COVID-19 when it becomes available, looking at how we prioritise those most at risk within our society as well. And planning is underway, conversations with local vaccine coordinators, so to make sure that as we gradually get vaccine available to us, how we deploy that to best effect to make sure that those who are most likely to benefit from it receive it as early as possible.
And the final question is, will you give the local authority, local health boards, actual definitive plans, how they roll it out, so we don't see some of the situations we had in other health boards recently over mixing up children's flu vaccine programmes prioritised rather than and using that plan for other things?
All the detail of that is currently being worked through with those vaccine coordinators, and that's been discussed both
so
within
firmly put down.
Being discussed both within a Scottish context but also a UK context, recognising that there are some regulatory considerations as well to make sure that as packs become available to us that they're going to be able to be used in the most efficient way.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I call Stuart McMillan, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, First Minister and Dr Smith. My first point is I'd like to say a thank you regarding the Waterfront Cinema, which is an independent cinema in my constituency, which received £250,000 from the Independent Cinema Recovery and Resilience Fund. So thank you for that. In terms of the questions, I wrote to yourself, First Minister, on Monday. It was later in the afternoon. And I'm writing on behalf of some of the hospitality trade within the Edinburgh Clyde area, who had some discussions with them on Friday in an online format, who raised their concerns extremely strongly regarding the positioning of Inverclyde in Tier 3 as compared to what their perception would have been for Inverclyde to be in Tier 2. And certainly with the document that and the tiering that was published last week, looking at the indicators, Inverclyde had levels 1 and 2 in the various categories, apart from the present level, which put Inverclyde into Tier 3. And I think we all accept us, we are part of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. But with the ICU forecast being at 2, then there was a sense of frustration as to why Inverclyde would be placed in Tier 3 as compared to Tier 3, to try to assist the hospitality trade to continue trading until the next review period is to take place. So I'd be grateful to try to understand some further information as to why Inverclyde would have been placed in Tier 3 as compared to Tier 2, please.
Gregor will want to say more about this. I would say, and this may or may not be a situation that is confirmed or might not be later in the week, I'm not sure we are yet confident about the stability of the situation in terms of just the raw indicators in Inverclyde about whether they are, you know, they look relative to the rest of Greater Glasgow and Clyde to be low, but are they sustainably low? Are they starting to drift up again? Or so there's some, you know, there's some questioning there. There is also, and this was set out a bit more fully last week, there is just the geographical positioning of Inverclyde relative to surrounding areas that have higher levels of transmission. Clearly, we have travel restrictions in place. In terms of guidance, we are actively considering whether we give a legal underpinning in future weeks to these travel restrictions, and I'll probably say more about that at the review point next week. But whatever approach you take to travel restrictions, it relies on people abiding by them. You will always have a risk, and I don't mean to sound pejorative about human behaviour, but we have to recognise realities. If you have a geographic situation with Inverclyde versus other parts of Greater Glasgow and Clyde, with pubs and restaurants significantly different in terms of their operation to other areas, you pose a risk to Inverclyde of an importation of the virus. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm saying you have to have pubs closed in Inverclyde for as long as they're closed in Glasgow, but these things start to be a bit of a consideration. And then there is, if you take Inverclyde down a level, and I keep making this point because I think it is one that everybody always has to bear in mind. Taking an area down a level is partly a recognition that it's going in the right direction, but we've got to guard against seeing it as a kind of neutral reward for that. It's not neutral. You increase transmission as you open up in a lower level. So would we be opening up risks of the virus spreading in Inverclyde when the people of Inverclyde are then dependent on hospital services across Greater Glasgow and Clyde that are under quite significant pressure? So going back to the convener's initial question, this is the territory that is much more judgment-led and therefore, by definition, a bit more subjective, and therefore, I understand, by definition, harder for people to kind of get their heads around and understand. But it is really important that we take that broader contextual picture into account when reaching these decisions, because the decision about whether an area is in level 0, 1, 2, 3 or 4 has a big impact on what will happen with the virus. So if you're going to take an area down a level, you have to be sure that the increase in transmission that is likely to allow, everything else tells you that you can cope with that without things quickly running out of control. Gary, do you want to say anything?
So I think we started off the session by talking about the holistic approach that we took when we were making these judgments, and some of them are very difficult. Inverclyde would include in that basket has been one of the very difficult judgments that had to be made. And it's a good example of why that holistic approach is very, very important. Because had you looked at some of the data alone without actually the overall context, different judgments might have been made, particularly if you were stuck and locked into a mechanistic process. And I think that would have been a huge risk for Inverclyde that we may yet see play out in terms of the data that we're currently tracking in Inverclyde as well. One of the considerations which I think is really important here is that geographical positioning with high levels of infection surrounding the area on all its kind of land border sides just now. And that places it, first of all, at a much higher risk. And we know from experience in Inverclyde from the first phase of the pandemic that the communities there suffered really quite a disproportionate impact of the virus already. And yet we don't have confidence, and neither should we have confidence, that there is a level of immunity there just now that would protect them from subsequent infection in the future. And therefore that we know the characteristics of that community, both in terms of their age, their demography, and some of their life experience, that they may be susceptible to further rises in cases in the future again. All of these factors are taken as part of that holistic assessment when we're trying to make the, as I say, the very fine judgments about how do we safeguard the public health of that area first and foremost from the threat posed by COVID-19. Now, we continue to track the data in that area to make sure that we are aware of any changes. One of the points that I think has come out in some of the questions that we have answered today is that when you see the data on a piece of paper, it's a point in time that you're seeing the data from. What perhaps is much more important is to see that data in the context of the trajectory and the intelligence that comes from the public health communities in particular. Because once you place it into that context, raw data that is on a decreasing trajectory, you can be much more confident about than one which is either oscillating or even increasing. And where there's an area where there is that uncertainty and a lack of stability, I think it's right that the precautionary principle is applied and that we safeguard public health first and foremost.
I accept everything that's been said. I think the one aspect I would highlight, just in terms of the location and the geography, Dundee is in 3, Perth and Kinross is in 2. The distance between Perth and Kinross, the distance between Perth and Dundee is shorter as compared to Greenock up to Glasgow. So in terms of people potentially travelling either way, then the same argument could be used certainly for Perth and Dundee as compared to, well, same with Inverclyde and elsewhere. And so that certainly adds to the aspect of that the Tier 2 consideration for Inverclyde hasn't been fully considered or accepted as compared to elsewhere within Scotland.
These things are all fully considered, and we will never be in a position where everybody's happy with the decisions that are reached. The precautionary principle here is important in terms of if there is uncertainty about the stability or the direction of travel of an area, particularly an area, as CMO has said, with a demographic picture that we know has heightened susceptibility. And particularly, I would say, with Inverclyde and the experience in the first wave of this, if you're asking me what side of that, you know, cautionary divide I think people in Inverclyde might want us to fall on, it's the one that says don't expose the population to higher risks of greater transmission that we judge to be safe at the moment. And I know that is difficult for businesses. I absolutely know that, particularly hospitality just now. But it is not, if we have the virus run out of control in all or part of Scotland, the restrictions that will end up being on business, including hospitality, will end up being, you know, more severe and possibly in place for longer. Suppressing the virus is really important for health, for life, and for the sustainability of the economy. And it's also why, going back to the point earlier about, you know, how and who takes the final decisions on this, they're always going to be difficult. I can go into my email inbox, as I'm sure all of us can, on any given morning, and I will see, and these views are taken on their own terms, are all legitimate. I'm not arguing they're not, but I will have about the country as a whole, about different parts of the country, about schools, about pubs, about all sorts of things. I'll have people saying shut them, I'll have people saying open them, and all sorts of gradations in between. And we have to come to the balanced decisions on this, which are really difficult. What I would say, and I don't say this because I could be sitting here this time next week and the picture could look very, very different. There is no part of me that is complacent about any aspect of this. But the decisions that we have taken so far, some of them will not have been right. I hope most of them have been generally right in a difficult situation. But we're in a position right now where, relative to many other countries, we're not, I don't think anybody could describe their position on COVID as good, but we're in a less bad position. So that says to me that that cautious, precautionary approach has probably served us not too badly, and we should continue with it. Because I think longer term, that possibly takes us to where we all want to get to, maybe more quickly, but with less loss of life and less general damage to the economy than doing it in a different way.
Thank you. Can I just ask one brief question? After the decision has been taken in terms of a tiering, is there some type of either verbal or written briefing sent to the local authority and the health board as to why those decisions have been taken?
We publish this last week, the kind of brief statement of reasons. Obviously, we will communicate more detail to local authorities, and you know, we'll try and make as much information available as we can about what drives those decisions. The difficult bit of all of this is, and I think this will develop as we go further into this kind of approach. The difficult bit is explaining as clearly as we all want to some of the more subjective and less tangible, in a data sense, factors that lie behind some of these decisions.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Our final set of questions come from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, First Minister, Dr. Smith. I wonder if I could ask two or three questions, please, that are coming from constituents in Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley. The first one is a bit of a follow-up to Stuart's question. First Minister, it's about why we changed the boundaries of concern from health boards to the local councils. A number of my constituents are asking me that, particularly in relation to Ayrshire. As you know, we've got three authorities, north, south and east. They're all at tier three. The household restrictions have been in place for a while now. So the question I'm being asked is, why did we move that boundary shape, if you know what I mean, so that people could move within Ayrshire and Arran, to now restrict them and ask them to stay within each of the local authority boundaries?
So there's a number of reasons for that decision. It was a decision many people suggested we made. Firstly, local authority boundaries have a guess in terms of a sort of political, democratic decision-making, you know, consultation, accountability sense, local authority boundaries have a meaning that perhaps health board boundaries don't have. I think in an understanding sense as well. I think, I'm not saying everybody understands the boundaries of the local authorities. I suspect most people have more of a sense of the boundaries of the local authority they live in than the health board area they live in. But it's also just about getting to a level that allows us to be as proportionate and as targeted as possible. Health board's boundaries health board areas are much bigger than local authority areas. So it allows us to go down a level without going to a level that probably would be impractical in terms of a levels approach. And it also, in coming on to your point about travel, you know, if you have a situation right now where, I would go back to Stuart's point about Inverclyde. So previously, the travel guidance was, for me, a resident of Glasgow City, don't travel outside Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board. But that would still have enabled me, as a resident of Glasgow City, with a relatively high prevalence, to go to Inverclyde with a relatively low prevalence and potentially complicate things in Inverclyde. So the travel, we've not talked about travel restrictions very much here, but they are an absolutely essential part of the sustainability of a varied approach across different localities. And unfortunately, the wider you make people's ability to travel, the greater risk you have of taking the virus from low to high, from high to low prevalence areas. And that is what we must guard against. don't know if you want to add any more in terms of the boundary decision.
I think what I would add is that one of the characteristics we've been tracking probably since late July is the contribution of travel across the country, both domestic and international, to the re-emergence of the virus cases. And there is no doubt in my mind that travel makes a significant contribution, particularly from those areas of higher disease prevalence to lower disease prevalence. And it's one of the things that we need to continually remind ourselves is that the risks of importing disease to those lower prevalence areas is very real, and it's something that particularly our more rural communities have experienced during the course of the outbreaks that we've been managing as well just now. At this point in time, and we continue to review the travel restrictions that are in place, but in my view, the best way of applying those at this moment in time is to make sure that we are not allowing the travel from those higher areas into kind of lower areas, and just in the way that the First Minister has described. And although there is a little bit of variation even across the level three areas just now, which is significant enough for us to factor that into our thinking, it's particularly important when we get to the travelling from between levels, and it has a much greater impact in that sense. Mm-hmm.
Just briefly to follow on that, does the data though tell you that you had to move from an Ayrshire and Arran boundary to three boundaries within Ayrshire? Is the data driven that, or is it a general concern that travel is a big issue and we can affect it by introducing that measure a bit better?
I wouldn't say the data in an Ayrshire sense drove that decision, but it does allow you in future — it's not the position right now where there's a level three category across all of the Ayrshires, but it would allow you in future, if my home part of Ayrshire, North Ayrshire, suddenly had a low prevalence and East Ayrshire had a high prevalence, to have a differentiated approach. Travel would be absolutely essential to that, or restriction travel would be essential to maintaining that. So it allows greater targeting, should the data take you in that. To be honest, the bigger your building blocks, the less ability you have to target and be proportionate. And you know, we may get to a situation again where the virus is spreading so consistently across large parts of Scotland that effectively we're going to bigger building blocks, because although we might still have councils as our starting point, the same level of restriction is across, you know, so much of the country. But if we keep going in the right direction, it allows us to be much more targeted and not have one part of Ayrshire under restrictions that are driven by another part of Ayrshire's experience, if we get to that position.
Okay, thank you for that. My next question is about visits to care homes. First Minister, there's been some really helpful relaxations announced recently that are really helping families to get through this, both visitors and residents in the care homes. My question is, is it up to the care home themselves whether to permit inside visits inside? Because we've had some pretty heartbreaking scenes where families are standing outside in the rain, looking in a window to try to speak to a relative. And I've been involved in one of these myself. So what's the thinking about whether we can permit internal visits? And is there any additional help you can offer the care homes who are perhaps struggling to provide a visit facility, whether it's in a garden or mm-hmm. not? So any measure to help there would be greatly appreciated by families and residents.
I'll ask Gregor to say a bit about the process and the decision-making process and the role of directors of public health in that. Just very briefly from me, I absolutely understand how horrendously difficult it is for a family who has a relative in a care home and they can't visit normally. It's for all sorts of reasons. It's awful, but it's also really difficult when we have outbreaks of COVID in care homes, and that puts the lives of frail elderly people at risk as well. So of all, in this whole situation, every day it's just a series of really difficult balances we're trying to strike. This is possibly the most difficult, and trying to get that right. And, you know, there's no perfect way through this, but particularly as we have higher community transmission again, the need to do everything we can to stop outbreaks happening in care homes becomes ever greater, and we can't lose sight of that. albeit that we want to facilitate as much normality for families as is safe and reasonable to do.
There's been many heartbreaking things that have happened as a consequence of COVID-19 landing on our shores, but I think one of the things which I think has been most difficult for people is that restriction to visit loved ones in the place that they call home. And that's been incredibly difficult for families, for staff, to be able to deal with over the time that we've been tackling COVID-19. So being able to relax some of those restrictions was, in my view, a real move forward, and was compassionate and recognised that actually these were people's homes and you know, the right to be able to see family and mix with them and be reassured by that contact was something that was very important. But the evidence suggests that the greater the footfall through facilities, the vulnerable institutions like care homes, the more likely introduction of virus is likely to occur. So there needs to be a balance in terms of how we manage that risk. And what we found from experience both within this country and examining experience elsewhere too is that as community cases begin to rise, as you start to see that disease prevalence rise in the areas where the care home resides, they become much more likely to experience outbreaks themselves. And so there needs to be a balanced and proportionate approach then to how you assess the risk for those. And we think that locally, the directors of public health, with the leadership that they've shown in managing these outbreaks, are perfectly placed to be able to support that risk management process, working with care home owners in particular to examine the mitigations that have been put in place for these care homes, how the care homes are coping with that, the testing programmes that are put in place and participation in those, to make a very balanced assessment as to where does the risk lie, where does the greater risk lie? Is it in opening up the visiting indoors, or is it in restricting the visiting and therefore restricting contact with loved ones? These are really, really difficult decisions, both for the homeowners and for the directors of public health to be party to. But caught in the middle, of course, are the residents of these homes and their families as well. So please be assured that they're not taken lightly, that the directors of public health are happy to be part of that decision-making process and continue to be that way. But sometimes, because of the very real public health threat that exists of introduction into these homes, sometimes difficult and unwelcome decisions need to be made about it.
Mm-hmm. I really appreciate those answers. Thank you for that. Have I got time for the third and final question, Convener? First Minister, just finally to return to one of my favourite subjects and possibly your own, football, and the ability or otherwise for the supporters to participate in the game. Firstly, do you think, are we asking a bit much of the players, not just in Scotland but throughout the world? There's a lot of positive tests coming in for footballers in the professional game in Scotland and across the world. So do you think it's fair to ask them to be continuing to participate to this degree? And are we asking them to take on too many risks, or are there sufficient protections that the clubs can put in place to fully protect their players and staff, do you think?
I should preface my answer here by saying Mr. Coffey and I enjoy a Ayrshire football rivalry, but I won't go any further into that. Suffice to say, I support the senior team in Ayrshire. if not in actually technical terms, but in all sorts of other senses. Are we asking too much of football? I'm probably the wrong person to ask here in some respects, because although I support the best team in Ayrshire, I'm not the most, I wouldn't describe myself as the most avid practising football fan. I think football wants to, and elite sport generally and community sport want to operate as normally as possible, and we've tried to facilitate that. There are very rigorous procedures and protocols in place to allow footballers and other sports people to operate, and there have been some across sports, there have been some breaches of that which compromise the ability of sport to continue in a footballing sense. We've seen that with Aberdeen, with Celtic, and actually in the last couple of days with Rangers players, which is equally concerning as was in the other situation. So again, it's like many things, we have to strike the right balance. And you know, we will continue to have this dialogue with the footballing authorities. But I don't think I'm mischaracterising this in any way when I say probably most of the pressure from the footballing authorities is to get back to more normality, particularly around having fans in stadiums and obviously in level one areas. And you know, we've got some games coming up in those areas that may have some ability to have fans in, but we've got to be very careful about that. We've got to continue to be very cautious. So we'll continue to try to get these balances as right as we possibly can.
Mm. And just to remind the First Minister convener that the team that she supports has never won anything and probably never will.
We beat your team quite a lot, actually.
Mine, won everything. But could I just finally follow up on the different codes, the professional, junior and amateur, First Minister? We've been approached, as a number of members have, from the amateur code to ask for parity of treatment with the junior code. We expect the juniors may be able to go back into action soon. The amateurs say to us quite clearly that they operate the same levels of protection that you'll find in the junior code, and just to ask whether there's any thinking to permit the amateur code to recommence soon as well.
Look, these things remain under constant review. Gregor, who can probably talk more authoritatively about football than I can, might want to say a word or two. I suppose the point I would make briefly, and I'm obviously making it in the context of your question about football, but it is a much more general point that I understand that the pressure we get from all sources is to open up, get back to normal. We're still dealing with a pandemic of an infectious virus. So from the perspective of the government, we are still looking at how do we sufficiently limit human interaction to avoid the virus taking off again. So, and that is, it is about decisions around individual sectors or sports or, you know, aspects of our life. But it is also a consideration of just the cumulative impact of if we were to agree with every request that was made to open up or get back to normal, what does that do cumulatively to our ability to keep the virus suppressed? So, you know, and sometimes that cumulative consideration leads to one area or another thinking they're not getting parity of esteem or they're not getting equal treatment, and that is difficult. So we try to be as consistent and as even-handed, but let's not forget where we are just now. We're in the face of a second wave of a infectious virus, and if we allow too much human interaction to happen normally, that virus will rip through our country and do a lot of damage, and we've got to stop that happening.
I think all I would add to that is that I wholly understand the concerns that are being raised there just now, and at this stage in the pandemic we continue to be very cautious in terms of our approach, I think rightly so, but my colleagues have got very good and developed very strong understanding and good relationships with all of these sports, and continue to engage with them just to try, first of all, to keep them abreast of how things are developing, but also to support them and to look to see how they can help to develop mitigations, ways that they can get back to action as quickly as possible. So we'll continue those discussions, and when things feel like the right time that we can start to change the restrictions that are in place again, please rest assured that as a sports enthusiast, not just a football enthusiast, we'll get the country back and participate in as quickly as possible.
Thank you both for that. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Willie. Can I take this opportunity to thank both the First Minister and the CMO again for their evidence and time this morning. It's enabled, I think, all of us to get a greater understanding around the decision-making that's made when it comes to the framework. So thank you again. We don't expect to have a committee meeting next week. The next meeting of the committee is expected on the 18th of November, when we will consider the motions on the statutory instruments upon which we heard evidence today. And clerks will keep members informed. Before we leave the room this morning, can I remind everyone of the guidance that I stated at the beginning around social distancing? And can I now close the meeting? Thank you.